Hello, my name is Craig Kundrat. I'm the director of the latest addition to the Science Mission Directorate, the Biological and Physical Sciences Division. And it's my pleasure today to give you a brief overview of the division's research. In BPS, we are experimentalists. We use the spaceflight environments to study biological and physical systems in ways we can't on the ground. We examine phenomena under extreme conditions, like weightlessness or under exposure to deep space radiation, to help us better understand how they function. And we use this knowledge to both enable exploration and to benefit life back on Earth. We have a twofold mission: to pioneer scientific discovery and to enable exploration. To pioneer scientific discovery, we are guided by our decadal survey, which was produced in 2011, and our midterm assessment, which came out in 2018. And we're just on the cusp of beginning our second decadal survey with the National Academies. We use these to proactively seek out new ways to expand fundamental scientific knowledge using the spaceflight environments. But as pioneers, we're also keen to assist others that are new to the field, and we provide expertise and support to help them learn how to utilize space for their research as well. Secondly, we enable exploration, specifically the human spaceflight part of NASA's exploration missions. We anticipate and investigate critical areas for scientific knowledge and technology development, and we deliver the results to other NASA organizations, like the Human Exploration and Operations Mission Directorate and the Space Technology Mission Directorate. BPS consists of two program areas, space biology and physical sciences. Let's first talk about the space biology program. On the left-hand side, you see that space biology spans a very wide range of biological systems. We study plants, animals, and microbes at the organism level, and we also go down to the cellular and molecular level. We also look longitudinally, that is over time, at development, reproduction, and evolution. In general, for a given area of research, the schema on the right applies. The first step is to see how the biological system responds to the spaceflight environment. The second step is then to design experiments to tease out the underlying mechanisms and to develop models for predicting their behavior in space. This often requires the development of new technologies, and once the work is complete, we promote open science for both the data generated during our spaceflight missions and also the leftover biospecimen samples, which may exist through the conduct of the investigation. We use this information to provide a mechanistic understanding to support human health in space, whether it's the crew or growing plants in support of the crew, or understanding the microbial environment of the spacecraft that's interacting with the crew and the plants on board. And we use all this knowledge to also benefit life back on Earth. At the bottom right of this slide, you see our two major databases, one of which, the Life Sciences Database Archive, also contains biospecimens. The physical sciences program is also very broad. It includes fundamental physics, fluid physics, by which we typically mean two-phase flow, like liquid and vapor, complex fluids, also known as soft matter physics or condensed matter physics, combustion science, material science, and biophysics. On the right-hand side, you see that we often use the spaceflight environment to investigate fundamental laws of physics using microgravity or the long distances that we can take advantage of in space. Like space biology, we seek a mechanistic understanding of the phenomena that we observe in the spaceflight environment. And to do this work often requires the development of technology. And once complete, we deposit data from the spaceflight experiments into the Physical Sciences Informatics Database, which is open to everyone on the planet. And we use these results to support the transfer of knowledge and technology to terrestrial systems on Earth to benefit life on Earth. To do this work, BPS uses a wide range of platforms. On the top, you see space-based platforms. And by far and away, our workhorse is the International Space Station. However, we also do some work with CubeSats and with free flyers. Shown here in the middle is the Russian Bion free flyer, which we've done many investigations in collaboration with the Russians. The upper right of this chart shows the future platforms we're very keen to use, the Lunar Gateway and different platforms on the lunar surface. Lunar Gateway has access to deep space radiation, unlike the ISS, which is in low Earth orbit and has a different radiation field than deep space. Lunar Gateway will have a complete deep space radiation field, which is important for biological experiments. And on the lunar surface, that radiation field will be modified a bit by lunar albedo. And also on the lunar surface, we'll be encountering 1/6 G as a gravitational force. So its impact on both biological and physical systems is very much of interest. But in addition to these flight-based platforms, we use a wide variety of ground-based platforms. For example, drop tower at Glenn Research Center, parabolic flight, sounding rockets or suborbital vehicles, etc. And these are typically used as stepping stones to prepare for flight experiments, to work out the details of hardware performance and test conditions for the spaceflight experiment. To give you a flavor for BPS research, let's consider a few examples. Our first example comes from some ground-based research that was being conducted in preparation for a flight experiment. Simon Gilroy at the University of Wisconsin needed a technique for the remote monitoring of calcium signaling in plants growing in space. After developing this technique, he applied it to some Earth-based investigations, as shown in these time-lapse videos. Turns out, glutamate triggers calcium signaling in plants to indicate the presence of a wound. Shown first here in this clip is a larva eating a plant leaf, and you can see how the bright calcium wave propagates through the plant. And in the second part of this loop, you see how a cut leaf sends a signal throughout the entire plant, much like a nervous system. Our second example is from an ongoing investigation on the International Space Station, Microbial Tracking 2. Video shows Jack Fisher collecting surface swabs on the ISS. In this investigation, 24 surface samples were collected on three different occasions over the span of a year. The bacteria collected were sequenced, and 123 genes conferring drug resistance were isolated. Samples were also collected from crew members during this investigation, from their skin, ear, mouth, nostrils, and saliva. This is an ongoing investigation, but early results indicate there's quite an exchange, as you might expect, between the surface microbiome of the crew and the built environment of the space station. This is a very important area for us to understand for long-duration exploration, where we may have crew that are basically in a closed environment for 30 months going to Mars and back. Switching to the physical sciences, here's an ongoing ISS experiment, burning rate emulator. The fuel ethane is being pumped in from the bottom of the slide. On Earth in 1G, the flame would be a brighter yellow and have a pointy structure like a candle flame. The size would be steady since it doesn't need to seek oxygen as the hot air rises and brings in fresh cool air with fresh oxygen to the side. But in microgravity, the flame front expands as the flame seeks out fresh oxygen. And as it grows, it gets dimmer, primarily due to radiation, the heat being radiated away and cooling the flame. Now, in this particular experiment, the investigators are modulating the fuel flow rate based on the temperature of the at the burner and the heat flux to mimic the combustion of paper, plastic, and alcohol. And in this way, get a better handle on the ignition and extinction behaviors of those substances, those materials. And this is a much faster way to get data than actually putting in solid samples and burning them, which is a very crew time intensive task. So the whole point of this experiment is to try and get a lot more data much quicker on the ignition and extinction of important materials. And our last example is another physical sciences experiment ongoing on the ISS, the Cold Atom Laboratory. This is the world's first multi-user facility for studying ultra-cold atoms in space, particularly Bose-Einstein condensates. Why do this in space? Well, even a Bose-Einstein condensate formed on the ground falls due to gravity just as rapidly as a pencil does. But in the weightless environment of the International Space Station, the Bose-Einstein condensates essentially float to first approximation and require much gentler containing forces for their study. So larger assemblies can be made at colder temperatures. So far, over 100,000 different runs have been performed on the Cold Atom Lab, going down to sub-nanokelvin temperatures and enabling studies on things like atom labors and bubble geometries, as shown here on the bottom right. Cal also just recently was awarded the AIAA Space Science Award for developing and delivering the highly innovative Cold Atom Laboratory to the ISS and for seminal scientific achievements. So hopefully this presentation has given you a good sense of what we do and why in BPS and given you some examples of the kind of work we do. But before we close, I'd like to share with you the status of our decadal survey, our second decadal survey in this area. It's about to formally start in December of 2020 or January of 21. And as you know, white papers are a key input to the decadal survey process. The American Society for Gravitational and Space Research is providing forums for researchers and service providers like launch providers and payload developers to collaborate on white papers to feed into the decadal survey process. Their website is shown here. Right now, in late November and early December, they are conducting a series of town halls on different topic areas that will be followed up with a series of more focused meetings in January. And those will be available live for free registration, or if they're in the past, you can go to the ASGSR website and look at the recorded material. You can also visit our BPS website shown at the bottom here, the bottom link. And we very much would appreciate your involvement in our decadal survey process. So to conclude, BPS pursues a twofold mission of pioneering scientific discovery and enabling exploration. We use different aspects of the spaceflight environment to study biological and physical systems. We use many platforms, mostly ISS, but other flight platforms and Earth-based platforms, and we're really looking forward to using Lunar Gateway and the lunar surface. Space biology and physical sciences both study a broad range of systems in their purview. And lastly, our second decadal survey is about to begin, and your participation is most welcome. Thank you for your attention, and stay well. Thank you.